Dat is denk ik het makkelijkste. Dat denk ik. Ja, dat is denk ik het meest eenvoudige.
Good afternoon, everybody, and a warm welcome to the American Enterprise Institute. My name is Dalbo Rohak. I'm a research fellow here at AEI, and gives me an enormous amount of pleasure to welcome Minister Johan Van Overtveldt to the Institute. Many in this room will surely remember the Belgian general election of 2010, which the new Flemish alliance won by a landslide, and which led then to coalition talks that that lasted for 541 days. But I remember that election very well because I got married the following weekend, and at my wedding, my best man wished the bride and myself that our union last longer than Belgium. So I'm happy to report that 5 years later, both Belgium and my marriage are still standing strong. Of course, Belgium has complicated internal politics, partly because of the relationship between Flanders and Wallonia. And like other Eurozone countries, it has experienced a relatively sluggish recovery from the crisis of 2008. The country suffers from a chronic public debt problem. The country, moreover, as we are very often reminded in public debates in Washington, does face the challenge of keeping in check the radicalization of some segments of its Muslim immigrant population. In other European countries, such challenges are typically associated with the rise of authoritarian populism, and oftentimes are used to explain the support for authoritarian populist parties, particularly on the far right. Yet that phenomenon seems to be, if anything, receding in Belgium. So Vlaams Belang, the anti-immigrant far right Flemish party, enjoyed its heyday over a decade ago. In 2007, it received three times the amount of votes, roughly speaking, than in 2014. So as such, as we write with Stan in the invite for this event, perhaps Belgium can provide interesting lessons for other European countries. Maybe a look at Belgium could be informative for understanding some of these developments throughout Europe, so, and across the Atlantic, indeed. So we'll try to unpack some of these in our conversation with the minister. Now, Minister Van Overtveldt has a PhD in economics from the University of Antwerp. Before entering the world of politics, he worked as a journalist and in the private sector, as well as teaching macroeconomics at the University of Hasselt. In 2014, he was appointed the Minister of Finance. He's the author of this book on the Chicago School, a very nice and informative look at the history of economic thought, and more recently of a book with this title, a subtitle of Why the US Will Dominate the 21st Century. Certainly claim that will resonate in Washington. Before becoming finance minister in 2011, he published another a book under slightly less optimistic title, The End of the Euro, The Uneasy Future of the European Union. So the idea for this afternoon is for the minister to deliver some short opening remarks, which will be followed by a conversation with my colleague Stan Voiger and myself, and then we'll open it up for Q&A, and we'll aim to conclude by 6 p.m. Thank you. Minister, the floor is yours.
Good afternoon to you all. Mr. Roach, I think your knowledge of Belgium is excellent. So when we have a next government crisis, I shall make the suggestion to invite you. Maybe you can contribute to the problems we need to solve at that point in time. Thank you very much for the invitation. It's an honor for me to be here. And what I would like to address today is what I, in my own thinking, as an economist and now as a Minister of Finance, or what you in the United States call the Secretary of the Treasury, what I have come to define as the need for a fourth awakening in economics. And I'll try to explain what I mean by that. And I want to start by a very brief comment on the economic situation in my own country. Belgium is a small economy, is a very open economy, one of the most open economies in the world. And the environment we have now already for a few years is characterized, per definition, I'm talking now about the international environment being very important for a small, very open economy, by relatively low oil prices, very low interest rates, and a quite attractive dollar-euro exchange rate. On the back of an envelope, on the basis of historical experience, that kind of environment should give us in Belgium at least 2.5% economic growth. We don't have that, by far. We are now moving slowly in the direction of 1.5. The years before were even lower. So that's quite unusual, given the historical experience and given the environment which we have now. By the way, it is a more general experience in the European economy that countries are experiencing lower growth than what one should expect on the basis of, again, the environment I just very briefly described. Why is that so? I think there is one word for me that explains a lot. In economics, there's never one single explanation, and that single word is uncertainty. There's a lot of uncertainty, there's always uncertainty, but let's say that the level of uncertainty for investors, for producers, for consumers today is quite high. A brief list. First of all, of course, in the European context, Brexit. Where will that process lead us? Let's be honest, nobody knows. There is a European election cycle with, on Sunday, as you probably all know, an important election in France. An election in Germany in September, if I remember correctly, and one in Italy coming up early next year. First, uncertainty. Second, geopolitical tensions, Syria, North Korea, Ukraine, ISIS. I think there's a lot to worry about in terms of geopolitics and the tensions related to that. Third uncertainty, the clearly rising threat of protectionism, which has something to do, of course, also, not alone, certainly not alone, but with the new administration here in Washington. Fourth uncertainty, what's happening in China? There's been, to put it mildly, a substantial increase in overall debt levels in China. It's still going on. The level of debt, or the volume of debt needed to get additional growth, seems to be increasing quite rapidly, and we all know that that kind of mechanism doesn't work eternally. Last in my list, element of uncertainty, the central bank policies have been very unusual, to say the least. It's also an open question, because we've never been there before. Where do we go from here with the levels of balance sheet volume that all the major central banks in the world have now reached? And I want to focus on that last element in my list of uncertainties weighing heavily on production, investment, and consumption. Where do we go from here with those central bank policies? And I'd like to place that question in the context of what I describe as the big step forwards that have been taken in economics over the last 2.5 centuries. I think some perspective is once in a while necessary and interesting to take. I admit that it is based on a very rough and personally inspired take on the evolution of economics and the policy issues related. But I see four big steps in the evolution of economics. The first one is clearly anchored on the date of 1776, the American Declaration of Independence, with all the emphasis on individual liberties. It was also the year that James Watt, presented the first, what we would call today, industrial application of his steam machine, and then most of all, as far as I'm concerned, the publication of The Wealth of Nations of Adam Smith, where we got the first systematic analysis of an economic organization based on the principles of free market, on competition, on what Smith labeled the invisible hand. The basis, the Smith's analysis was the basis for a market-driven economic system that brought an enormous increase in welfare. If you put GDP per capita, gross domestic product per capita, and you draw it for the last 2,000 years, you see essentially a flat line, starting even before year zero, a flat line, more or less a flat line, up until the mid of the 18th century, and then you see an increase that becomes quite impressive. Adam Smith described the system, described the way in which competition works and leads to advancement. He described the necessity for the rule of law, for antitrust in order to safeguard competition. He stressed the need for sound money, and he also stressed the need for government to take up the role it needs to take up in terms, for example, of the provision of public goods. The second big step, and now I take a substantial step through history, is the Great Depression of the 1930s. There it was clearly proven that that kind of market system, market-driven economic system, can break down. It happened before, but the scale on which it happened in the 1930s during the Great Depression was enormous. We saw there an economic, social, and political tragedy of major proportions, leading, amongst others, of course, to the Second World War. Out of that disaster came the general theory of John Maynard Keynes. By the way, 2 years later, Keynes was already saying that, of course, he needed to write another general theory, but that's another story. The general theory of Keynes was taken up massively by economists, and the major take from the analysis of Keynes was the government can and should provide full employment through the manipulation of aggregate demand. Budgetary policies especially should be used in order to keep a sufficient level of aggregate demand in the economy so that we would have almost continuous full employment. The working horse of that Keynesian mechanism was, of course, the Phillips curve that showed a trade-off between inflation and unemployment. And the way in which it was developed and was translated into policy was that it worked almost like a hydraulic system. Governments could run along the curve, higher inflation would produce lower unemployment and hence more economic activity, and vice versa. This Keynesian insight led to two major developments. The first one, and maybe the more subtle one, but for me a very real one, was that Keynesian approach towards economic policy led directly and indirectly to an expansion of the welfare state. Because implicit in the Keynesian thinking was that we had unlocked the secret of economic growth. We know how we could produce continuous economic growth, and you don't have to worry that much about rising debt levels once you're sure, whether it's correct or not is another issue, when you're sure that you can provide economic growth on a continuous basis. And I think that has been, maybe most of the time implicit, but anyway, an important driver of the growth of the welfare state. And we all find out, certainly today, that if growth comes down a little bit, I'm not speaking about recessions, that of course then higher debt levels become something you really need to worry about. A second major development out of that Keynesianism was that the Phillips curve trade-off ran into the ground. And by the 1970s, we saw combination of rising inflation and rising unemployment, which according to the Phillips curve was just impossible. And it was Milton Friedman, together with Edmund Phelps, who developed the insight that you needed increasingly higher levels of inflation to produce the same kind of result in terms of employment and economic activity. And so an inherent bias towards higher inflation was built into the system, which by the mid-70s was quite clearly the case. And out of that situation, those of us who are old enough to remember that inflationary period and what it took to contain that animal, came the third awakening in economics. You use monetary policy to create a stable environment, to create stable prices, and you let competitive markets take care of the rest of your economy. That's what you need in order to have a smooth economic development. Under the same umbrella of that third awakening, I place the discovery, also to a large extent to be identified with Milton Friedman, that when you took his analysis of the Great Depression, he came to a substantially different conclusion than Keynes. For him, and he documented that in the massive monetary history of the United States, the Great Depression became the Great Depression because the authorities allowed a collapse of the money supply. And that collapse of the money supply was in its turn caused by the fact that the authorities let bank collapses run their course unchecked. Major lesson that was part of that, what I call the third awakening in economics, and that served us well when the 2008 great financial crisis arrived. And I think, I'm sure, that the then chairman of the Federal Reserve, Ben Bernanke, said explicitly that he thanked very much Milton Friedman and his collaborator Anna Schwartz for the insight they provided, because a few years before the financial crisis, during some celebration of Friedman, he said, we won't forget the lesson you taught us. And indeed, it must be said to the credit of Mr. Bernanke that he applied the lesson that was brought forward by Friedman and Schwartz. And he didn't allow, together with the people of the European Central Bank, the Bank of Japan, Bank of England, etc., he didn't allow the financial system to collapse as it collapsed in the 30s. That's where we are today. We prevented, or the central banks prevented, a collapse of the system comparable to what happened in the 30s, and the result would certainly also have been comparable. And I think we now need indeed in economics a fourth awakening, because we are now close to 10 years after the start of that great financial crisis. Actually, the summer of 2007 was the real start of the crisis. And I think there are two big issues still left on the table. First of all, what to do to prevent a catastrophe like we experienced in 2007-2009? And secondly, if, even when all the precautions have been taken, a crisis like that arrives, did we now learn enough to take care of it in a better way than we did this time? I'm not criticizing the way it has been handled this time, but I think it's clear that we should think and think very hard about better ways to try to solve the aftermath of the crisis. With respect to the first issue, what to do to prevent a catastrophe like the one we experienced in 2007-2009, I just want to put some questions on the table to which I don't have the answers. And that's my call for a fourth awakening in economics, in terms of policymakers, or policymakers need answers to those questions. The first question is, do we yet fully understand the important ways in which a textbook market economy differs from a monetary economy? A monetary economy in which, that's often forgotten today, in which the money creation does not take place through the central banks, it takes place through private financial institutions. That's where the money creation takes place. We often forget that, but that's a major issue, and I still think we don't really understand all the consequences or the context of that. Second question, should monetary policy, instead of focusing solely on price stability, also focus on financial stability? In other words, should monetary policy also look at, for example, credit creation, leverage in the economy, risk-taking? Third question, banking regulation. A lot of work has been done, a lot of things have been changed. Did we go far enough in terms of capital requirements? Or did we go too far? And what's the future of risk-weighted asset evaluation? Because clearly, the world is changing rapidly around us, and hence what is a risk today is maybe something different tomorrow. There was a time when Greek government bonds were considered to be risk-free. Fourth question, do we fully understand the moral hazard issues that inevitably come to the surface when you organize financial rescue operations? Do we understand the mechanisms that work there? And do we understand the moral hazard that can take place in the build-up of, for example, financial bubbles? Last question for me. Are we sufficiently able today to distinguish between a liquidity crisis and a solvency crisis? Is that distinction possible? And if, how? My second block of questions has to do with, do we really now know what to do? And there, I think, also specific question need to be answered or need to get an answer as soon as possible. Did we hang on too long to QE? Or not long enough? Or not voluminous enough? Did we have to go in Europe to negative interest rates? Negative interest rates. And do we fully understand what the consequences are at different levels of negative interest rates? Related to QE, another question. Did we exhaust future demand by relentlessly trying to bring it forward? Because that, of course, was one of the major purposes of QE. And last question, do we know how to deal with the many misallocations that inevitably takes place during a boom, if not to say a bubble phase in your economy? And then, of course, I'm referring to misallocation in the real economy, in the real estate sector, and other sectors of your economy. So I think these are all very important questions to which we today have, at best, let's be honest, partial answers. And that makes life, believe me, quite difficult when you're in policy making, because I think each of the questions I put on the table confront are on my table or other ministers of finance or heads of government. I am not saying continuously, but quite often. Judgment calls have to be made. They have to be made always and everywhere. But given the degree of uncertainty that we have today, it makes life rather difficult. And I dare to say that uncertainty today is a little bit above its long-term average. I relentlessly push my fellow economists to try to get answers to these questions in order to be able to reduce uncertainty, because I think that's what really needed to get our economies back to higher levels of economic growth, and that's what we need in order to solve or deal with other problems and issues. Thank you very much. Back here?
Yeah, that's right. Thank you very much for those remarks. We're going to do, say, about 20 minutes of conversation, and then we're going to open it up to the audience. There's a very wide range of topics that I think we want to touch on. But the sort of first one, and I guess this is the core of the speech you delivered. I mean, there have been efforts for a while to build a financial sector into macroeconomic models. And I would guess that, you know, the people who work in that subpart of macroeconomics would argue that they have discovered things and they have made some progress. How optimistic are you? And there's been a lot more work on sort of the financial chunk of the monetary transmission path since the crisis, also on banking supervision, on those things. How optimistic are you about that progress? Do you think, you know, we'll get the conclusive results in that subfield of economics? Or do you think that, you know, 20 years from now, we're still going to say, well, we have answers, but they're at best partial, they're very contingent, they're very context specific, which I think is still the case for, say, research on fiscal policy, right? So we have results on how large gains and multipliers are, but the results vary. They seem to be very context specific. There's certainly a lot of disagreement within the profession on how big those effects are. I just want to get a sense of how optimistic you are that we will get answers to the questions you posed, which I think are all very good questions, and I agree with you, we don't have full answers to them. Right?
Well, of course I can give a very short answer and say I'm confident or I'm not confident, mm-hmm. but that's not the answer you're looking for, of course. I'm pretty confident that we will get more answers because of the brain power that is also in economic research now is of course also globalized. And so I think we can get increasing returns to scale there too. So I'm quite optimistic there. Now, of course, one of the points you made and which is very correct is that economics remains human science. I remember that I already referred a few times to Friedman. He once told me that for him, economics is about the question, why do people do what they do? And I think that remains valid today. And when you institute new regulations, new capital requirements, whatever, there's always the question of how will, in this case, for example, banks, financial institutions, investment funds react to what you create as new regulation. But I think the profession, which was on a path to some level of overall agreement, give or take, by the time the crisis erupted, has realized that the dynamic stochastic general equilibrium models were oversimplified given what was happening in the real economy. And I'm pretty optimistic that we will come up with answers to some, at least, of the questions I've been putting on the table. And of course, it will be a trial and error. Don't forget that technological evolution is not standing still either, also for the financial sector. And there's a whole new fintech branch that is evolving very rapidly and is changing the financial sector in a very substantive and structural way. And that will bring new issues to the forefront, but we will have to start running to keep on able to catch up with those evolutions. But overall, I am pretty optimistic that we will make progress and that we will be able to create a system that is more crisis resistant than the one we had until recently.
Well, that's good. My colleague Dalibor is typically a little more pessimistic about the world and where it's headed, so I want to give you the chance to share some of that pessimism or optimism, if you want.
I suppose understanding economics as first and foremost a human science requires accepting the notion that there aren't necessarily policy fixes for everything, and I think that includes the financial sector and systemic risk. that perhaps the efforts to engineer away volatility and risk might make us more comfortable, but with that they bring the seeds of their own demise, sort of channeling the risky behavior to areas of the financial industry that are not quite yet regulated. So accepting that we are necessarily living in a world that's going to be imperfect, that we'll see fluctuations, I think is one corollary of adopting that sort of restrained view of economics that it seems to me Friedman would advocate. But I want to shift the gears just a little bit. So 2011, you wrote a book with this cheerful title, The End of the Euro, and the book, if I'm not misrepresenting its core message, argues that unless there is a fundamental rethink, overhaul of the architecture of the monetary union, Euro will eventually unravel for the reasons that would have been, I suppose, accepted and understood quite well by monetarists of the Chicago school. Now you're a finance minister of a Eurozone country. Have you changed your mind? Because I don't think we've seen quite the unraveling of the euro yet. Neither have we seen the sort of reshuffle of the fundamental architecture of the monetary union. Yeah, so.
Well, let me start with your last remark. I don't fully agree with the last part of your remark, because the structure of the monetary union has been changed substantially. Not sufficiently, but substantially. And I'm especially referring to the banking union, which at the time I wrote a book was more an idea than something that existed in reality, but that by this time is to a large extent a reality. And I think that in terms of the institutional reinforcement of the whole euro infrastructure, a very important step forward. We need to do more. We need to do more because we all know how the monetary union was born in the early 90s. It was more political kind of idea that got translated into monetary terms. And the conditions you normally should have in order to have a well-working monetary union were at that time not present. The reasoning being, it will come as we will have difficulties and crises, and then we will look for solutions. That path has shown to be somewhat difficult. But indeed, I changed my opinion to that extent that what we realized, of what has been realized up to today, especially in terms of the banking union, was something I didn't think was possible at the time I wrote the book. That's the first thing. And a second thing that I learned in the last 2 years, that I underestimated when I wrote the book, is the amount of international pressure that has been put on euro policymakers to get the house in order. Of course, I talk a lot now with colleagues of mine who were already around at the time of the euro crisis. And I was amazed that the pressure that came from the United States, but also from other areas and countries, was really very strong. I underestimated that. And I think that many European policymakers realize that they have their responsibility not only vis-a-vis the euro area and the European context as such, but on a more worldwide scale, because obviously if the euro area would run into real difficulties, that would have implications not only for Europe, but for the world at large. So yeah. These are the elements on which I think my thinking today is different than it was 5 years ago when I wrote the book.
My very quick follow-up to that is that your party is part of European Conservatives and Reformists in the European Parliament, and Tory-style conservatives would typically be wary of EU's changes that would transfer more authority to Brussels, that would require deeper levels of integration. And it seems to me that many of the elements of a functioning monetary union would require a higher degree of policy coordination in the area of structural policies, perhaps system of fiscal transfers, the banking union. How do you square the traditional conservative demand for more self-government with the practical requirements of having a workable monetary union?
Well, my party and I myself, we plead for, we take what we call a Euro-realistic view. We want Europe to function better. Not necessarily that, it's not necessary for us that Europe does more. We want it to do what it does better. And for example, in terms of the monetary union, there is not a shred of a doubt in terms of my thinking and that of my party, that we need to do what needs to be done in order to have that monetary union working in a proper way. We are very clear about that. And so we are absolutely convinced that more Europe is not the answer for all the questions. You hear people screaming that all the time. We think that's wrong. I think there are certain issues that can better be dealt with at a national or even regional level. But there is certainly an important place for Europe, but in a more realistic, in a more specific way than what we have been doing until now.
And so what are areas that you think are done at the European level now that maybe shouldn't? What are things that are done at the national level that maybe should be done at? I do think that your party is a little different from the British Tories in the sense, of course, that there is a, you know, you may want to, you know, devolve some authority to a more local level than a national level. And, you know, having a more integrated Europe in some ways will facilitate, I think, that kind of regional autonomy. I think that's a fair representation of your views. What are policy areas that you are concerned about are being taken up by the European authorities too much? What are policy areas where you say, well, we can push that to the supranational level a little more?
Well, to take up the last one, where I think there is ample room for Europe to make an important contribution to overall welfare and well-being in Europe, is at the energy level. Because there I really think we are of course faced with a very important issue, given, for example, the constant turmoil in the Middle East,
or in Ukraine,
the gas coming out of Russia, etc. I think at the level of energy policy, thinking about that on a European level can bring important advantages for all those concerned. And I think with respect to that, we should be more daring. And we should be more, how should I say, innovative in order to get that situation in a way that we could take advantage of the scale that we could have if we attack the problems on a European level. Where I am hesitant to go the European way is in terms of, let's say, social policies. Because obviously, you cannot apply the social system that you have in a country like Belgium or the Netherlands in countries like Bulgaria or Romania, which are at totally different levels of economic development. And you should be very careful to harmonize everything that comes in that direction in the same way. And even more explicitly, I am very hesitant about harmonization at a tax level. I'm all for transparency. It should be crystal clear what all of us are doing, how the corporate tax system works, whatever, transparency 110%. But when you start talking about tax harmonization, you should be careful, because if you look at all the European countries, you have a few very large countries and you have many smaller countries. And the big countries have the scale advantage of being big. All other things equal, a lot of the international investors will, per definition, go to the bigger countries. And so the smaller countries need to have tools to compensate for their scale disadvantage. So I don't see any contradiction in pleading on the one hand for the utmost transparency in terms of tax and tax systems, and at the same time being very careful and hesitant about tax harmonization at the European level.
How worried are you that on these social policy and economic issues, how worried are you that losing the UK as an EU member will translate into a push for more harmonization of social policies and more of a leftward shift on the tax front?
It's certainly so that, and certainly with the present government in the UK, that the more conservative, liberal economic thinking will lose an important supporter in the EU context. That's for sure. So if and when the Brexit becomes fully operational, if I may put it that way, that would certainly, on the basis of what we see today, increase the inclination to get to more interventionist policies. But of course, you can have government changes in France, in Italy, and then of course the whole combination or the picture changes again.
Talking about France, what do you think of the election? Are you excited about all four candidates that are leading the pack?
Well, let's say not by all four. No? I think well, we can be quite clear about this, that if on Sunday we would end up with a second round tournament between Mrs. Le Pen and Mr. Mélenchon, that would be quite dramatic for France and for Europe. On the basis of what we see in the opinion polls, chances of something like that happening are not that big, but are not zero, far from it.
I think it keeps Dalibor up at night.
Yeah. It does indeed. Going back to Brexit for a moment, you said that we don't really have a very clear idea of where this process might lead, but here is one possible scenario. So Flanders, unlike Wallonia, have long been deeply economically integrated with the UK. So the exports from Flanders to the UK were of the order of magnitude of roughly 27, 28 billion euros. That's from the number from Wallonia is roughly the 1/10 of that. We also know what the Wallonian government did with the EU-Canada trade agreement last year. And I don't necessarily want to give the Minister President of Wallonia any ideas, but aren't you worried that this asymmetry of interests and perspectives when it comes to the future relation between the EU and the UK could lead to troubles when an agreement is reached and is to be ratified?
Well, it will certainly lead to discussions. Whether it will really lead to troubles, I doubt. I doubt really, but it will certainly lead to discussions. Now, I think in terms of the Brexit discussions, there are other issues that will become quite burning at relatively short notice, and that have nothing to do with Flanders or the Walloon area, but that have to do with how Europe, the 27 others, are going to negotiate with that one country that is the second economy of the continent, and that is of course then on its own and negotiating with 27 other countries. It will be an interesting process to follow.
On a more optimistic note, one of the books that Dalibor showed earlier is a book you wrote 3 years ago on the US and why it will dominate the 21st century. There it is. You can buy it on the internet. And the idea, the sort of the central idea is that in a rapidly changing environment, the U.S. has certain, unique capabilities that will allow it to adjust better than other economies. We're 3 years later now. A reality TV show host is the president of the United States, and there's, more of a protectionist tone, more of a push for maybe industrial policy, things like that. Are you still as optimistic about the U.S. and its dynamism and its ability to adapt as you were 3 years ago?
The short answer is yes. And of course that needs some explanation.
Mm-hmm. Yes, please.
Or you would ask for it. So, uh-huh. Because the United States has been through experiences like this before. If you look at the history of the United States, more protectionist inclined presidencies, the isolationist tendencies are always more or less there, come to the surface, go back again. The question, of course, is whether the first of all, will Mr. Trump do what he said he would do during his election campaign? I think on some issues it's quite clear that he will do it. On other issues it's much less clear what will happen. So we'll have to see. But that basic giving of a country that is built on the phenomenon of change and looking for change and embarrassing change, that remains as it is. Can that over time be killed? Of course it can be killed. But I think that can be done in one period of 4 year time. And like I said before, we first have to see where the Trump presidency in terms of policies eventually will lead to. The thing I'm most worried about is, like I already said in my introduction, is the protectionist tendencies that seem to be there. And that's of course something coming from, again, a very open economy for a country with a very open economy is something that you may be awake at night from the French election. I'm awake at night over protectionist measures being taken worldwide.
Well, that too, of course.
That's Tuesday night. Yeah.
Before we open it up, my last very short question is about your book about the Chicago School. Is there any, if you had to single out one lesson of classical Chicago-style price theory that you think gives you an edge over your colleagues, Eurozone finance ministers or other political actors who have not been perhaps quite as careful scholars of the history of economic thought, which lesson would it be?
If you change the incentives, the attitudes and the actions of people change. It was it has always been like that, and it will, I think, always be in the future like that. It's all about incentives, and good policy is about changing incentives or trying to change incentives in the way that you think it will change human behavior so that you get the results on a macro level that you want to obtain. But incentives always play an important role.
For example, if you build an economic department surrounded by a war zone where it snows constantly, people will work really hard.
But of course, with the internet, that has changed a little bit also. But it's
So let's open it up to the audience. Questions welcome. Let's start here in the middle in the back. And please wait for the mic. Then introduce yourself very briefly. And ideally, questions end with a question mark.
thank you. Yeah, good advice. My name is David Marsh. I'm with a think tank called OMFIF in London. I wonder what you think the long-term future of France really is within the euro area, because it's not just the four candidates, all 11 candidates, only 8.5 of them seem to have a very negative view on Europe, and it does seem to be quite widespread. There's also this very large inferiority complex against Germany, which seems to have got worse and worse in France over the years. So even if Monsieur Macron were to win, given the fact he doesn't have a party behind him, and given the fact that it's a pretty hostile electorate there towards more European sharing of sovereignty and so on, I just wonder whether France, under almost any constellation, can sign up to a Europe where people are abandoning sovereignty in different ways in order to fulfill the dream of Maastricht.
Yeah, I think, and it's something that you in your books on European situations have been referring to also, I think it's very important to have a good understanding of the German-French relationship in Europe, and that relationship has always been crucial for Europe. I like to describe it as the locomotive that has been pulling the European train at practically every important instance we got since 57 with the Treaty of Rome and everything that came after it. And clearly there's something wrong with that locomotive today. And what is wrong, according to my humble opinion, that you have indeed the or should I say, the intrinsic weight of each country has begun to differ too much. The difference has become too large. In terms of soccer, Champions League, Germany is playing Champions League, France clearly no longer in the Champions League. And that's a problem, not only for France, but also for Germany. Because the logical situation would then be that Germany would start pulling the train itself. But given historical circumstances, the Germans don't do that. Or don't do that in a structured way or in a constant way. France itself, I think all the economic indicators are flashing. Debt is rising very rapidly. The government or the part of the public sector in the economy is close to 60%. Unemployment is high, youth unemployment is sky high, very concentrated in certain areas and in certain parts of the population. And I think it's quite clear that the socialist type of policies that we've had now for several decades in France don't work, or work even in a negative way. So the first question, I think, is what will France do with its internal policies? How will they eventually change policies or not? And of course, I refer to Madame Le Pen and Mr. Mélenchon. If we go that way, then I think it's, let me put it this way, all bets are off. What would happen and how the financial markets would evaluate that kind of situation. So I think the attitude of France towards Europe can only change if France changes its internal policies in a substantial way. And I'm not only talking about economic policies, but also other social policies.
Let's go right here. Yeah.
Hi, thank you very much. My name is Dimitri. I lived in Belgium for a few years, so I love your country and mostly the people. So
I want always come back.
I plan to. I come often, actually. So I want to pick up on your point of the expected growth of 2 to 5% that you expect in Belgium based on the condition.
2.5,
not 2, sorry. So my question is not very monetary in nature, but I think it's the low growth is related to negative interest rates and uncertainty. So I've heard it argued that in the 19th century there were major breakthroughs in physics and chemistry, and in the 20th century those made applications to engineering and technology. In the 20th century had breakthroughs in biology, and that in our century will lead to medical breakthroughs. So my question is it possible in the 20th century we had traditional economic growth that was easier to measure, and now in the 21st century we have economic growth that is much harder to measure? So part of this fourth awakening is maybe finding a way to measure economic growth and increase standards of living in a better or different way. So I guess my specific question is, which parts of the Belgian economy are you seeing growth in, and which ones are you not seeing growth in? And more generally, if you could comment on this measuring economic growth and increased living standards. And if I can get a bonus question in, is what is the proper role of finance as a percentage of GDP in a normal economy like Belgium? Thank you.
Thank you very much. With respect to the first part of, or your first question, or major line you made.
Question one.
By the way,
question one,
very,
B2.
Very good, yeah. Remarks. Let's be clear about that. It is indeed so that with the present, composition of our economy, measurement problems have increased. We are measuring what we are measuring, but are we really measuring what we want to measure? And there certainly is a case to be made, although I should add that to my list of questions to ask to economic researchers, in an economy that has become for 80% or 75% a service economy, it becomes much harder to measure, especially productivity. And we all know that in the long run, like Paul Krugman once said, it's not all about productivity, but practically all about productivity. And if you talk about economic growth and increase in well-being, GDP per capita, it is about what happens to your productivity. So yes, we have a measurement problem there. And the sooner we solve it or can solve it, the better it would be for us. But
You also refer to a lot of technological changes that are taking place. And what we see today is that these technological changes take place at an increasing speed. That's one of the points I make in my book on the United States. We not only see change, but we see an accelerating rate of change due to all kinds of development in terms of human capital and things like that. So these measurement problems are important and makes it more difficult to have a good judgment on what is happening to your productivity, which is essential in order to judge what's happening to your economy. And then the question about finance, we were certainly too high. You must excuse me for not having the exact numbers in my head at this point in time, but finance certainly had become much too important in terms of our economy, part in the economy, by the 2007-2008. But on the other hand, you cannot have a well-functioning economy without a well-functioning financial system. So there will always be an important place for a financial system in your economy. How large it is depends, of course, on a lot of different issues. And for example, a country like the UK, with London as the major financial center practically of the world, things are different from a country like Belgium, where traditionally the financial sector is somewhat less important.
Shall we do one more question?
You're the boss.
All right, let's do it. Let's go here, the person in the back.
Hello, my name is Emma Weisberg. I'm an undergraduate student at the American University here in DC. I wanted to open up the conversation a little bit. You mentioned at the beginning that you see these elements of uncertainty in Belgium. And when I think of uncertainty in Belgium, the first thing that really comes to my mind is security, given that Belgium has been victim to several terrorist attacks in the last several years. So I'm wondering what you think of really just the intersection of these two major uncertainties going on in the country right now, and how the lack in really a strong security system that may have allowed or like let these terrorist incidents slip through may affect the work that you're doing now and the state of Belgium at the moment.
Yeah, it is beyond any doubt that there was some negligence towards security issues up to, let's say, 2 years ago. We started to invest. We started to try to get things to where they should be in terms of providing security. The attacks of March last year were, of course, on a quite massive scale for a country like Belgium. A lot has been changed. Law and order forces have been reinforced. Also, the state intelligence forces have been reinforced. I think we are much more aware now of what is happening in, let's say, sensitive areas, let me put it that way, so that we can take much more preventive actions on the security side. And there's still a lot of work to be done, but I think we've done a hell of a job in 2 years' time in order to improve that situation that had deteriorated indeed a lot in Belgium.
How do you think Belgium will do in the 2018 World Cup?
We'll win.
I'm a little jealous these days.
We went twice up until the quarterfinals now, okay, in the with a team consisting of players that are all playing outside of Belgium, in the British competition, in the French competition. So we should have a very good team by that tournament. And I was joking when I said we would win. I would be very disappointed if we would not get this time beyond the quarterfinals. Let me put it that way.
Okay. Well, on that modestly optimistic note, I think we're done here.
Thank you all for coming.
My pleasure.
There's some refreshments served outside. And we hope to see you at AI again very soon.
Thank you
very much.